So we just quickly where we are. We are trying to solve the problem of actual swept back wing, trying to calculate its divergence speed and the effect on aerodynamic lift, and make it, we will also make sure that it produces the entire the lift that you want it to produce. Okay, so we are doing three things simultaneously, and because the aerodynamic loads depend on the deformation, we really cannot use principle of stationary potential energy. We need to go to principle of virtual work. For swept back wing, the flow stream requires the angle of twist to be about and about the axis which is normal to the flow stream, but the structural axis gives us angle of twist and bending along a line which is different than your x bar line. So as a result, we have to resolve our transverse deflection slope dw by dx and our angle of twist slope theta along this line. Okay, so theta is very simple. It gives us a component of theta cosine alpha. As you can see, dw by dx is a vector along this line. So when I resolve it along the x bar axis, its component is going to be in the opposite direction. So that's why you see the negative sign. Okay, so the total angle of flexible angle of twist that the wing sees is theta cosine lambda minus partial w partial x sine lambda. So as a result of this, our aerodynamics get coupled. Okay, that means that bending and torsion cannot be that you cannot study divergence without bringing in bending now. Okay, so that's why the entire analysis of swept back wing is an order of magnitude more complex than that of a straight wing. And we wrote the expression for delta w external, came out pretty complex looking. Now we are focusing on u. This is the variation of u due to virtual displacements, and then this is where we stopped. So we said in principle of virtual work, what you do is you assume the value of w x, you assume the value of theta x. So one thing you will notice is we are not solving any differential equation. We are dealing directly with the strain energy and the external virtual work done, but but don't think that differential equations have no role. These expression you see for strain energy, these expression you see for external virtual work done, they really come from the actual differential equations. Okay, so when we are done with it, our hope is that we have solved those differential equations approximately. We will satisfy the essential boundary conditions exactly, but we will not satisfy differential equations exactly. Okay, we also will not satisfy the natural boundary conditions at the free end, that the bending moment and the shear force are zero at the free end, and the torque is zero at the free end exactly. But as we keep on adding more and more terms in this expansion, you would notice that they also get to satisfied pretty accurately. Okay, so your entire accuracy will depend on how many terms you use here, but still nothing is explicitly satisfied except the essential boundary conditions. Everything else would be satisfied only in an approximate manner. This is an approximate solution, you have to remember that. We are not dealing with the exact solution to our problem, we just can't. These problems are very hard. You might be able to do it if it's a uniform beam, no taper, but for something like this, you will not be able to. Okay, so when you now substitute this all this expression in your expression for strain energy, and the potential of the applied load, what you do is you assume the substitute w x and theta x in the expression for external and internal virtual work. Then you use delta C I phi I and delta C I psi I as the virtual displacement. That means first you will assume what would happen if your virtual displacement is delta C 1 into phi 1. What would happen if the virtual displacement is delta C 2 phi 2, delta C 3 phi 3, delta C 4 phi 4, and then the same thing separately with psi I. When you are done with all that, you will obtain, for every single time you do any one of this, you are going to get one equation. And that one equation would be in n plus m variables. What are those n plus m variables? Those are n values of c's and m values of d's. Okay, those are your unknown now. Your unknown of the problem are n c's and m d's. Okay, so total unknown we have are n plus m. Does that make sense? Okay, once I give you all the c's, all the d's, you are done with solution of the problem, because you pick these phi i's, you pick these psi i's, you know them. Okay, the only unknown in both these problems, both these expressions are c's and d's, and that is what we are trying to find out now. So, I need to develop n plus m equations. If I have linear n plus m equations, I can solve for c's and d's. Okay, that is where I am headed. So, I get every single equation I would get is every time I choose one of these functions, I will get one set of equation, one equation in n plus m variables. Okay. So, I do it n plus m times, I will get equations that would look like this. Kw, some stiffness matrix, some matrix over here, some matrix over here, some matrix over here, some matrix over here, and then on the right hand side we would have things multiplying with q. And this is called the aerodynamic influence coefficient matrix. We talked about that in our control reversal problem. Okay. So, since there is no coupling in bending and torsion, if the transverse displacement rotations are assumed to be that of elastic axis, we get k w theta k theta w 0. So, this part over here and this part over here for us would be 0. There will not be any coupling, because if you remember, our bending strain energy is separate, it does not contain any theta term. Our torsional strain energy is separate, it does not contain any w term. So, as a result, when I apply this principle, I would not see any values for k w theta or for k theta w. You will only see zeros, because there is no term here in our u that is both a function of phi I and psi I. You only see coupled term if there is something in these expressions which is function of both phi I and psi I, or a function of both w and theta. Every time you have a term that contains both w and theta, you will see a coupling. But for strain energy, we do not see any coupling. But on the other hand, if you look at our principle of virtual work expression, that is full of coupling. So, you are going to see a lot of coupling terms when you get your A matrix, because see this term itself, for example, you have a good example would be what? This one. So, you have partial W x and theta being multiplied. Okay, you have this may not have any coupling. This would have, you have delta theta here and you have partial w partial x over here. So, you are going to have a coupling. Over here you have delta w and you have theta. So, you will see a coupling. Every time there is a product of delta w or theta or theta, or delta theta or w, you will have a coupling term. So, this whole thing is going to give you lot of coupling terms. So, this matrix is going to be full of coupling terms. I mean, if these were also 0, we just wasted a lot of time, right. I mean, the fact that somewhere we would have coupling terms that couple the two c's and d's. Okay. And these are the culprit, a w theta and a theta w, they are the culprits. Okay. And the matrix A would not be symmetric, that is why we could not use. If you end up with symmetric matrices, then you can show that you can, your integral, your work done would be independent of path taken. Every time you get into asymmetric or unsymmetric matrices, you cannot use principle of stationary potential energy. Okay, and our matrices you will see are all the A matrix. K matrix would be symmetric. Okay, K would be symmetric, but A would not be symmetric. So finding the eigenvalues of these matrices is not easy. So this is something we proved yesterday. Remember, we said K I j is E I phi I phi j. So that's that part we did yesterday. And K I j theta theta would come out to be G j psi I prime psi. So notice that these primes are same as what you see in the strain energy expression, because for the beam strain energy expression at second derivative, you are seeing second derivatives of phi I. Right? Because strain energy for torsion had first derivative of psi I, you are not, you are only seeing first derivative of psi I. Okay. Any questions so far? Okay. Now, if you notice over here, we have a QC vector and a QD vector, and let's see what do we see for QC. You get a vector when you only have either W or theta. You get a matrix when in the same term you have both, you either have a square of W or you have a square of theta or you have a W times theta, then you get a matrix. If you only have W by itself or theta by itself, then you will get a vector, because when you do your virtual work calculation, one of them cancels out and you are left with a vector. Okay. So this vector is what we call vector of generalized forces, and they would come out to be this. QIC would come out to be CX bar. CX bar is the chord at X bar, okay. And CL0, this is, this you know this, and phi IX cosine lambda is your, this is all, they are all coming from this term. This part is coming from this term of virtual, external virtual work. This term from here up to here, it has no theta or no W. This would lead to only a vector term. Okay. This term from here up to here, and including this term, they will only lead to a vector term. They will not give you a matrix. This also would not give you a matrix, because this has no product of theta delta theta with theta or delta theta with delta W x. So this term also would give you part of your aerodynamic matrix, sorry, that vector. The product of delta theta with theta and partial W over partial x would be part of our matrix term. Okay. So that is why you are getting two kinds of terms once you start to apply your principle of virtual work, on the right hand side, a vector term and a matrix term. Okay. Every time there is a product of theta with W or theta with itself, including that with delta W, you will get a matrix. Okay. You will get a matrix. So from those terms which do not contain a product of W with theta, or delta W with theta, or delta theta with W, you will not, you will simply get these two vector terms QC and QD, and QC and QD will come out to be this. Okay, so QC they are simply related to phi. Okay, because these are contribution due to transverse deflection to the load. Any questions about this? And QID only contains psi i's, because this is coming from the aerodynamic moment, because aerodynamic moment impacts our angle of twist. So these are all, if you notice, it has a CCM0 term, it has this EC term. Now you would also see this QIC also have the same term, but that one is coming because I had sin lambda into psi I prime term. Okay, so see this one has psi I prime. This term would have been zero if sin lambda was zero. Any questions up to this point? These are rather complex equations. I can see why you would have this kind of look on your faces. So once again, how do we get them? You get them by going back to this these equations. Okay, you substitute the value of d square w with dx square over here. That would be a summation containing c i's and phi I double prime. When I multiply with any of the variation term, for example, delta c I term, then that brings in phi I double prime term. But it gets multiplied with every single term in this expansion. This expansion has n plus m term, n terms, right? So because it gets multiplied with every single term, which is a summation, that's why, if let's say it was delta c 1, but delta c 1 is getting multiplied with delta c 1 phi 1 double prime is getting multiplied in this term every single term in your expansion. Okay, so that's why you would see phi 1 double prime square. You would see phi 1 double prime, phi 2 double prime, phi 1 double prime, phi 3 double prime, phi 1 4 prime, phi 4 double prime, and so on. So your first equation is, when I use phi 1 double prime, it is multiplying with every single term in that expansion. So as a result, you get a row multiplied by a vector of constants, because those constants are contained in this term. Maybe what I am going to do is, after our break, I will come back to this and do the math with you guys, because I really want to finish this before they tell it is 1 hour. Okay, this, because this is very important stuff, because this is the heart of principle of virtual work, how to get these matrices and vectors. I mean, you have to understand how I got them, because otherwise you. The reason you want to understand is because you would be, I do not know what problem you guys are solving. Whatever problem you are solving, you can take this approach and apply to your problem. If you can write this expression, if you can write this expression for your problem, this one, what is your external virtual work? What is your variation in the strain energy? If you can do that, you can solve any problem approximately. Okay. This is the classic principle of virtual work, and people have been using it for a long, long time. Mathematicians sometimes call it Galerkin method, but we in structures, aeroelasticity, call it principle of virtual work. So any and it becomes Ritz method if we have conservative problems. If you understand how I went from this equation to a set of equations like this, you can solve all your problems, because the basic notion is, we convert an a problem with infinite dimensions. That means, where I want to find deflection and slope at every point, I have converted my problem into a finite dimensional problem. I now have finite number of unknowns, n plus m. What we say in these approximate method is, we can express a infinite dimensional problem where you needed to know x, your theta and your w at every single point on the wing, which is infinite variables, right? You can replace it with a finite number of variables. You can decide what would be the value of n, you will decide what would be the value of m, and as you keep on adding more and more terms in your expansion, you will get better and better accurate solution to your problem. So somebody was saying they were studying flutter of a shear wing, I mean wing with shear. This is exactly what you would do. You will assume your w and theta as a function of, just like I am doing here. The only thing that would different is this matrix that you see, it would now be a function of frequency. Right now it is like, it's divergence is studying flutter at omega equal to 0. So tomorrow when we study flutter, you will get see similar matrices which are function of frequency. Okay, so same method, the principle of virtual work would be as applicable there as it is over here. So whosoever, I forgot who was studying flutter here of sheer wings, this is how you do it. This is exactly how you would do it. So you really need to spend some time when you go home today, and I'll spend some more time in the after the break, how to get these matrices for you. Because if you don't know how I got them, then you will, then rest of it is not that important. You really need to see how we got AWW, AW theta, and all these things. So coming back to this, this is what I would get for each of QI's. Every time I change phi I, for example, for x first function, let's say we pick x square over l square. I would substitute x square over l square here. I would perform all these integrals. I won't do it Mathematica or MATLAB or whatever you are doing. You can do this integral very easily. Then you do for x cube. Then you do for x 4. So every single phi I, you will get a QIC. Then you go to the second one, replace psi I with x first, because that's your first function we picked. Then you replace with x square, you will get the second value, x cube the third value. So that way you will complete your QIC, QID vector. Everything here is known to you because you know phi I, you pick them. There's nothing in this integral that's unknown to you. All you have to do is perform this integral now. And if you use simple polynomial, that's a very simple integral. And the good thing other is, I mean, cosine lambda, sine lambda, they are constant. They should really be outside the integral. You know. The only thing that is a function of x in this case is cx bar and phi I. Other than that, everything is constant. Just take them out. I was just too lazy to do that, but you should. Okay, now comes the hard part. This is what you have to spend some time on, how I got AIJWW. Let's look at AIJWW. Where is this coming from? AIJWW term is coming from this term over here. This delta W here, and when it multiplies with partial W partial X over here. Because in all these terms, that is one place there where there is a product of W and W. That's the one that's going to give you AWW. Okay, so if again sine lambda was 0, there would not have been any AWW. AWW is coming because of this sine lambda term and how it's interacting with partial W partial X. Sine lambda 0 means AWW 0. All right, then AW theta is coming from this term, its interaction with this term, and it's coming from this term's interaction with this term. These are the terms that they're going to give you AW theta. Actually, I take that back. You're going to get AW theta every time you have only delta W. So it would come from this term and this term, because that one has delta W, and it will also come from this term's interaction with this term. Okay, you get a row in our matrices because you have applied a virtual displacement corresponding to that row. So my first row would be what I would get when I say my virtual displacement in the transverse deflection is delta C 1 phi 1. Okay, that's where I'm getting my first row. When I use my virtual displacement equal to delta C 1 phi 1. Delta C 1 is going to cancel out on both sides because it's there on delta U and it's also there on the right hand side. Okay, delta U cancels out, but what would be left with is expansion of W and expansion of theta, and due to delta W. Okay, anything related to delta W. So this would lead me to a row, this interaction, with this one. Okay, that's what's going to give me delta any term in the. So make a note on your sheet that delta W times theta cosine lambda make a note, and make a note of delta W x into theta cosine lambda. Make a note of those two things. Okay, now let's see what we get for a w theta. I get for a w theta, this is what's coming from delta w into theta term, right? You don't see any prime over phi I because it was delta w phi I. Phi I was multiplying with everything containing theta expansion, and you also see cosine square lambda term here. In the second term is coming from our second expansion, delta w, delta of the dw by dx term. Remember the second term was dw by dx, and you see what do you see? You see a phi, phi I prime term here, because this is coming from the second term, and then it's multiplying with simply psi j, and this one was simply multiplying. Both are multiplying with psi j. You see that? Okay, so a I j w theta is showing up because in our principle of virtual work term, there is a term multiplying anything related to variation in transverse deflection. The variation in transverse deflection is here, and the variation in transverse deflection is here, over here. This one multiplied with theta cosine lambda, this one multiplied with also with theta cosine lambda, including terms like EC, partial CL, alpha, and all those. Okay. So, this term over here multiplying with delta W, this term over here multiplying with theta cosine lambda, and all this stuff, EC, partial CL, partial alpha stuff, that is giving me my first W theta terms, and that is what you see over here. That is what you see over here. Okay, this is where W theta is coming from. So, before I show you the next one, coming back to this picture, tell me which terms would contribute to A theta W terms. What would contribute to our lower half of the matrix A theta W? This one, right, multiplied with, that is all, right. There is nothing, is there something else that contains delta theta and W? No, right. So, make a note of this, make a note of delta theta multiplying with minus partial W partial x sine lambda, and the rest of the stuff you do not have to worry about, cosine square lambda, you know where that comes from. But the key thing to remember is delta theta having an interaction with partial W partial x sine lambda. What that should tell you is in your expansion for this A term, you would see from here, you would see a psi, this would give you a psi I term, this is going to give you a phi j prime term. Okay. So, the variation term give you the I term in your matrix, whatever I is by phi I or psi I, the inside term would give you the j term in your k I j or a I j or whatever. So, you would notice that when we go, I have not shown you yet, what you would see is delta theta. Let us say when I use psi I, psi I for example. Okay. So, delta theta would be related to psi I, and this would be related to phi j prime because of its derivative of W with x. Okay. So, let us see what do we get. What do we get is exactly that, we got psi I that is coming from delta theta, and phi j prime that is coming from dw by dx. And it is multiplying with sin lambda. If sin lambda was 0, I would not have this term. A I j theta w and a j a IJW theta, AIJWW, they are all there because of this little guy sin lambda. You put sin lambda equal to 0, there is no coupling, because then bending would not do anything to your torsion loads on your aerodynamic loads. Bending of a straight wing does not do anything to aerodynamic loads. It is because of sin lambda, partial dw, partial x, it starts to show up in your aerodynamic loads, because it changes the angle of twist that the wing sees. Okay. And this is straightforward, this has now, oh, this one is straightforward, it only have psi I psi j term, and this one comes from here. This one comes from interaction of delta theta with theta itself, and the only term that has is this term over here, delta theta is over here, and the theta term over here. If sin lambda was 0, this is all you would have, delta theta into theta, that is all you would have. All these additional, how many, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 terms we are getting, we have total of 6 terms, right, which are product. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Out of 6, 5 are there because of sin lambda. You take away sin lambda, you have taken away 5 out of 6 terms. What a mess, just because of sin lambda, you know. So, if it was a straight wing, all you would have gotten would have been just this. This would have been 0, this would have been 0, this would have been 0, and a theta theta would be the only thing left. And your entire problem simply would be k theta theta d equal to q q d plus q a theta theta d. So, that is what sweep does to the aerodynamic problem, it makes it very messy. So, whosoever is going to study flutter, and they are going to study flutter of a swept wing, they will have to deal with all this mess. But the funny thing is, sweep has very little effect on flutter. Unlike divergence, flutter is not as dependent on sweep as divergence is, and control reversal too. But the effect on control reversal is opposite to the effect on sweep. So, sweep helps us in divergence, but it hurts us in control reversal. Any questions up to this point? So, you have every term here now, okay. How good is it? Okay, so, in the absence of sweep, the only non-zero terms in the aerodynamic terms would be a theta theta matrix, okay. Because sin lambda, out of all the A matrix, A I j theta theta is the only one that does not contain sin lambda. The coupling between the bending and torsion completely vanishes. For unswept wings, one can solve the problem by only considering the torsional deformation, and that is what we did when we did our divergence of a plane wing, which was straight wing, we did not have to worry about bending at all. Okay, and the coupling is really in the A matrix, not in the stiffness matrix, and that is because the way I formulated the problem. I formulated the problem about the elastic axis. You can also get a coupling between bending and torsion if I had chosen the, for example, aerodynamic axis as my main axis. So this coupling terms are you can minimize them by picking proper reference axis. Okay. So, the bending torsion coupling in stiffness went away, because I picked shear center, locus of shear center as my reference axis. There is no reason for me to pick that, okay. I mean, you can pick whatever you want. You can decide to pick same axis for both of them, but as long as you are consistent with, as long as you know what you are doing. And do not feel so bad if, let us say, a theta w and a w theta are non-zero, not a, k. But in the K matrix, if you do an axis in which there is a coupling, you would see that your stiffness matrix would come out to be symmetric. But A matrix, if you notice, there is nothing common between, if you look at this term itself, if I interchange in the this term I and j, I am getting a completely different term, different integral. But the second one it would be same, second one would be same, right, because if I interchange I with j, I will get the same thing, but not in this term, not in this term. Similarly, over here, if I interchange I and j, I am not getting the same integral, okay, same thing over here, I am not getting the same integral. So, A matrix is not symmetric at all, but K should be symmetric because it comes from strain energy, because strain energy always has to be positive definite. If K matrix, your K matrix comes out to be unsymmetric, you have made a mistake, because what you are telling then yourself is there is a set of unknown C's and D's that instead of me doing the work on the structure, structure is doing work back for me. That means I am not doing work to deform it, structure is giving away energy when it gets deformed. How could that be? You know, all you have to do is sit on something and produce energy, but we do not have anything like that. So if your K matrix comes out to be unsymmetric, you are in trouble, something is wrong, something is wrong. Okay. So, the non-trivial solution to this problem only exists at some specific values of aerodynamic pressure. Have I already gone to divergence yet or what? No, I should, okay. Okay, yeah, so we have gone to divergence. So, when we do divergence now, what I am really doing is I would have these equilibrium equations at certain QC and QD, and I would say I want to study what would happen if I give a small change to C and a small change to D, that would be studying stability, right. So, when we do that, this term would drop out, and because this I have already used it to find what my equilibrium position is. Okay. So, for studying divergence, this term has no part to play. The only thing that matters is this matrix, and instead of C's and D's, you have a small variation in C and D. Over here you will have a small variation in C and D, okay. It will have nothing to do with this term anymore, because now you are checking, I have equilibrium, I know what my C and D's for a given Q are, now I want to see is what happens if I give a small disturbance to my system, okay. So, the only thing that, because this does not contain any C or D, this part does not, right, this is just the loading term, this is what impact low aerodynamic load has on the structural loads. So, you are just left with then this as your divergence problem. See, the C's have been replaced by a small change in them, D has been replaced by a small change in them on both sides, and that the vector term has gone away, because the vector term did not have any C and D in it, okay. Now, this is our classic eigenvalue problem. That means, the only this one solution to this problem is delta C 0, delta D equal to 0, this will be satisfied, or Q equal to 0. Okay. So, in that case delta C and delta D would again be 0. What we want to see now is there a value of Q for which this equation has a non-trivial solution, okay, or is there an adjacent equilibrium path? Is there a adjacent equilibrium that exists to whatever C's and D's you have found? Now, it is a linear problem, so your KWW, they are not dependent on theta, on C and D, but you could also do it for a non-linear problem too. The only thing is you will go to your equilibrium position and you will calculate these matrices corresponding to that, you would linearize them at that values of C and D. So, in general, if it is not a linear problem, these matrices would be, can be function of C's and D's, but you have already found those C's and D's, so this you can easily do yourself, okay. So that is the beauty of principle of virtual work also, I can apply it to a non-linear problem as easily as I would apply to a linear problem. But then my equations would be non-linear. That equations I showed you, they would not be linear. So this is now a classic eigenvalue problem. That means I can go to our friendly MATLAB or Mathematica. I give my K matrix, I give my A matrix, and I find at what speeds of Q this set of equations have a non-trivial solution. That set of Qs will be called divergence pair. The lowest value of Q one would obtain in now is called the aeroelastic divergence pressure, and it's represented by Q divergence. So recall that presence of sweep leads to a coupling between bending and torsion due to coupling in the A matrix only. One can also get bending torsion coupling by fabricating the skin out of composite materials. So remember I was telling you guys about that we don't build forward wings because of this coupling that reduces the divergence speed. You can overcome that by using composites. Okay, so you can use a composite skin that would give you instead of this kw theta and k theta w being zero, you can use composites in a way that this part of the matrix is such that it overcomes the effect of all these other matrices. Okay, and that's what X-29, if you go read about X-29 airplane, that's what they did. They built using composite skins and it was a swept forward wing. It was an experimental airplane just to test the fact that can we build a swept forward wing using bending torsion coupling coming out of composites. Okay, and they did that and it was successful. Any questions up to this point? So this is how you calculate divergence of a wing, and we'll come back to example later. But I just want to do some more formulation first. Then we'll see how it works out in an example. Any questions? No. Okay. Now these wings have to create a certain amount of lift. Okay, so it's called trimming of an aircraft with flexible wings. How much, let's say somebody gives you that this wing has to create half the lift, right? One wing has to create half the weight multiplied by whatever load factor you are flying the wing at. So lift is known to you, and if it was a rigid wing, you can very easily calculate at what angle of attack you should fly that you get that lift, because you know for the whole airplane you would know what your CL over alpha looks like, partial CL partial alpha looks like, and you can decide, okay, I need to fly at 3 degrees, 2 degrees, and I would get my required lift. The problem now is because of the flexibility of the wing, the total lift acting on the wing would depend on all these coefficients C's and D's, okay, and how much you have deflected. What's the angle of attack at E along each strip? Okay, so there is, if you want to maintain the same lift, chances are you will have to reduce the angle of attack. First of all, you also have to know how the lift is distributed. Why? Because that would decide how you will design your airplane wing. I mean, if somehow you have designed this wing in a way the outer of the wing has more lift, then you are in trouble, right? Because it's going to have a lot of bending moment near the root, and so you will need to stiffen it and all that. So you need to know what is the lift distribution you have for the flexible case. It's not going to be same as what you had for the rigid case, because the angle of twist has changed. You guys agree, right? And you need to know that. How do we do that? So that's the next part of this lecture. Okay, so let's see what the total lift on the wing looks like. The total lift on the wing is LAX bar DX bar 0 to B, and I replace my angle of attack with, this is the angle of attack I will have to give So I'm trying to now find out what should be my angle of attack that I get required lift. Okay. So alpha 0 has now become one of the unknowns. Okay. Because it has become one of the unknowns, I need one additional equation, and that is this additional equation that the total lift produced by this flexible airplane, flexible wing, should be equal to certain given value. Okay. So, we have one additional unknown, but we also have one additional equation, and this is that equation that when all said and done, am I getting the required lift? Okay. And this is that required lift, but and as you could see, it depends on our phi i's and c i, psi i's, okay, depend on that. This should be j. I have to go back and correct it. This should be j. Okay, so then this whole thing can be written as L w is the lift you are getting from the rigid part of the wing angle of attack, and the total lift you are getting from the contribution coming from theta and dw by dx. Okay. So, the contribution we are getting from angle of attack is very simple. It is simply C x bar partial C L partial alpha dx, and remember q is outside. Q is outside for all of them. That is why you do not see any q in any one of these. And the LJC, which is the contribution due to dw by dx, is here, and again it is because of sin lambda. If sin lambda was not there, I will not get any contribution to the lift from my bending deformations, but because of sin lambda, I have contribution to the lift. In fact, it is reduced, it is going to reduce it because of the negative sign. Okay. So, then I have, this is the contribution to the total lift due to the torsional flexibility of the wing. Again, the prime indicates derivative with respect to x, and the trial are function given of x. So, we need to convert everything into x, which is x is x bar over cosine lambda. That is a minor detail. So, in this case then you can write q c as coming from two different contributions, q 0 c and the contribution coming from C's and D's, okay, due to flexibility angle of attack. So, Q 0 C i, we they are given by this. So, that you see it has brought in phi i's and all that, but we had them before too. So, this part really is not changing. Okay. It is depending on this, but we had it before too. And Q alpha I C i are with respect to, you know, phi I, phi I prime, and q I or d is again due to psi I alone. I need to go back and check this term. This term has started to bother me. I will check about this term and come back to you, but it should be there, because I have checked this derivation many times. So it should be there. So when you do all this, your set of equations is exactly same. I mean, the first, this 2 by 2 and this 2 by, this is exactly what we had before. Okay, that has not changed. The only thing that has changed is this new additional equation that has come up with, because we want the total lift to be equal to Lw. Okay. We also got an additional equation. Okay, this is an additional equation, and in these two we also have an additional column. So, making sure you produce enough lift adds an equation, but it makes this matrix now instead of simply in terms of C and D, I have brought in another unknown alpha 0. Does this make sense to you? That alpha would change our expressions for QCI, for our CIs, for q's, and it would also bring in a new term due to alpha 0. So this is a new term that you get because of alpha 0. Okay, so solving this would make sure that you produce enough lift in your flexible case. Okay, so your set of equations have changed a little bit. So let's do some examples now. So we go back to a simple straight wing like we did this morning. Because it's a simple straight wing, I don't have to worry about any bending. Okay, the only thing I have to expand is theta x, and let's say we use three terms: ci x over l raised to the power I. Because it's, the wing is fixed at the root, we don't have to worry about constant term. We can start with I equal to 1. We don't have to worry about any of the ww or w theta terms or theta w term. The only thing that's of importance to us is kij theta theta. Okay, everything else drop out, and you can show that kij theta theta is equal to gj ij I plus j minus 1. Okay, because it's all you have to do is substitute psi I over here. If you substitute, go back and substitute your psi I equal to x over l raised to the power I over here. You will get gj psi over l, get the prime first and substitute over here, perform the integral, and you will see this is what you get. Okay, I am using that integral over here, over there. So this is what I would get for my kij. Then for aij theta theta, I would simply get this. I don't need anything else. Okay, all that aw theta, a theta w, that's not needed, because there is no coupling anymore. It's a straight wing. It's a straight wing, and I do the analysis first time with just one term. Okay, and we got divergence dynamic pressure to be 0.00334, and then with two terms it became 0.277, with three terms it became 0.0275. So you could see that the results have almost converged. If I go to 4, it would be pretty close to 0.275. Okay, so you have to do this convergence analysis. You have to add more terms and see if you are getting the right right amount, right value. You are converging to the right value. And this is taken from a book by aircraft structures by Maxson, and they gave Q divergence of 0.0275. Okay. And you can see the Mohr shape. By Mohr shape, what you mean is you will solve that eigenvalue problem, right? You will get your CIs, and then you will go back and substitute those CIs in C1 x over L plus C2 x over L square plus C3 into x over L cube. That is your what we call Mohr shape, or the in this case divergence mode. So you will not really know how the you all you can tell is what your shape would look like. Okay. So that is all you could tell, and this is all as you add more and more terms, you will get closer and closer to the actual Mohr shape. But we are still getting some error, because I am trying to represent a I think a sine function. It is more like a sine function with the three terms, and even though my divergence has converged, our Mohr shape is still not fully converged. Okay, so that's how you use principle of virtual work to do divergence. So let's do another example. Now let's suppose you have a tapered wing, and this one has a sweep. Okay, and we assume the chord to vary linearly, and the bending and torsional stiffeners are assumed to vary in the fourth power of chord as follows. So C is this, E is this, GJ varies like this, EI varies like this. It's a pretty complex problem now. Okay, it's not a constant coefficient equation term. This is the kind of problem you solve in real life when you do divergence and product calculations. This is how your GJ would look like, and these are some other dimensions, and this is our divergence problem. Like we said, you have the stiffness matrix and you have the aerodynamic matrix, And we are assuming W x to be x over L raised to the power I plus 1 and theta x simply x over L raised to the power I. The off diagonal terms come out to be 0, the stiffness term would come out to be integral of this for W w for theta theta. And if you do the math, this is what you would get for k w w, okay, and this is what you would get for k theta theta. And you do the math for all the a's. You do not have to do it, Mathematica or MATLAB will do it for you. This is what you would see in your a I j w w, this is what you would see a I j w theta. And the thing to notice is the moment sin lambda goes to 0, many of these things simply drop out, okay, many of these things simply drop out and you would have been left with only this guy. So, this is what you get, this is what you get in terms of your all the a's. And you then substitute back, I mean there is an solution available to this problem given by this. So, that is one thing you have to do every time you develop an approximate method, make sure you get hold of good one or two problems for which other people have gotten very nice results, exact, or you can trust those results, because you have to show that, you have to show that the basic math, there are two issues here, is my basic math correct, I might have missed a sign somewhere. Right, it is possible. Is my programming correct? Am I programming what I think I am programming? So, when you program something, you might miss a sign, you must miss it, instead of something raised to the power 3, you might put 2, 4, who knows. So, that is what makes what we engineers do so hard, because we have to go 10 times back to make sure when we program something, every sign is correct, every power is correct. We are not typing 1 where we were supposed to type I, you know, otherwise you are going to have just one term first coefficient instead of varying for different values of I. Trust me guys, I have been there, I have done all those mistakes, okay, and then you spend whole night thinking what did I do wrong, and then turns out oh my gosh, I put 1 where I should have put an I or L. So, be very careful, okay, always find good examples, because you have to solve those good, you have to get the analysis done. And we did all that, and we got divergence pressure to be I think 0.0178, and this is how it is converging, as you add more and more terms, it is converging to the right results, okay. So, this is how you could use approximate methods to find divergence of very complex wings, and principle of virtual work is very, very powerful, okay. But the important thing is you have all these integrals we did like this, we do not have to, you could always use numerical integration, right. You could computerize most of this stuff, whether using Mathematica or using actual numerical integration, but this is a very powerful approach, that is all I would say. Now, the same approach when you, instead of applying these shape functions which I applied over the entire domain, I could have broken the wing in several parts, okay. Then I would have the beam element, just like I have the beam stiffness term, I would have a beam divergence matrix, 4x4 beam divergence matrix. I would have a 4x4 beam torsional, 2x2 beam stiffness matrix, and I would have the coupling matrix, okay. So, if I write instead of my phi I's like the way I did, if I take my shape functions for the beam element, if I take my shape functions for the torsional element, which is simply 1 minus x over L and x over L, and I take my beam element functions, which are those 4 shape functions for a beam element, right, you all know them, those cubic polynomials, I can get this 6x6 matrix for each element, then it would be just 6x6, right, 4 bending terms, 2 torsional terms. So, you can develop that 6x6. Now, if we get a coupling with the other one like we did yesterday, then it would become 10x10, okay. But then I don't think that you will see any coupling in the bending torsion part. You will only see coupling in the bending part. Okay, so don't worry about that. So you can easily develop. How about that as something for you all to do? Take this formulation and develop 6x6 aerodynamic matrix. So go back to this. Go back to this expansion over here. These four terms, these two terms over here, because you already have the beam stiffness part. Okay, that part you don't have to worry about. Take your phi I, phi j, and take all these terms outside. You don't need sin lambda, cosine lambda inside. Okay, that just part of whatever lambda you have. You have to specify it. Because if lambda is 0, you don't have any coupling. So you can easily develop all this 6x6 matrix, and if you have a beam program where you have already assembled 6x6 stiffness matrix, you can use the same 6x6 assemblage process now to assemble your aerodynamic matrix, and you have a very powerful divergence calculation approach. Somebody give you, no matter how complex wing they give you, you don't have to use functions which are defined over the entire domain. Okay, so you can develop a 6x6 beam finite element with perform all these integrals, where you see phi i's, replace them with beam shape functions, four of them, right? Where you see size, replace them with the two torsion shape functions, like psi 1 is simply 1 minus x over L, psi 2 is x over L, right? And this phi I is, if I remember correct, 1 minus 3 over x L square plus 2 x L cube, that is our first shape function for the beam element. And the second one is something like 3 over x L cube minus x over 2 x L square, like that. Okay, so use those shape function and you have a good 6x6 beam program to calculate divergence of any wing. Okay, so I hope Dr. Sunny would mail you these slides. And again, please, if you find any mistake, do let us know. This is something I developed over the last semester just for you guys. Okay, this has not been presented before. You guys are the first one to see this. Okay. And it took me long time to type these things. I mean, I didn't spend much time deriving it, but it took long time to type it. LaTeX can be pretty painful, but you cannot get these nice equations with Microsoft Word. That you just can't. Any questions about this? What we did today on how to calculate divergence speed of a wing. All right, let's take 5 minutes break, and we need to cover something a little more for about 20 minutes, then I'll let you go.